Hi, it's Michelle from Lab Muffin Beauty Science, chemistry PhD, skincare nerd, and skincare user. We talk a lot about how to use your products, but today I wanted to talk about how not to use your products. So I'm going to go through some of the mistakes I see people making when using their products and why you shouldn't do that. If you like talking nerdy about beauty, click the like, the subscribe, and the notification bell so you don't miss any videos. First, the dropper on the face. I see this a lot on social media and I guess it looks really cool, but the issue is that droppers aren't meant to be used that way. And what I mean by that is the preservative system inside the product isn't designed to let you use it that way. So preservatives are put into a product to stop microbes, so bacteria and fungi, from growing too much. If you have too much bacteria and fungi in there, you can end up with really nasty infections when you put that product back on your face. The way that they test a preservative system is by mixing the product with fungi or bacteria, and then waiting and seeing how much fungi and bacteria grow. A good preservative system will actually decrease the amount of fungi and bacteria, it'll actually kill anything that's been added. With a bad preservative system, the bacteria and fungi might just not change, or they might even be allowed to grow. With challenge testing, the fungi or bacteria actually gets reintroduced, so partway through the testing, they chuck in a bit more. So this is meant to simulate what would happen if you dug into a jar with a dirty finger, or you touched a wand to your skin or lips and it wasn't completely clean. If the product passes this challenge testing, that means that you can put it in a riskier type of packaging, so like a jar or a product that has an applicator wand. And in general, products want to minimize the amount of preservatives they use. They want to put in just enough to do the job. Preservatives tend to be irritating and allergenic if you have too much. They are some of the more irritating and allergenic ingredients that you find in cosmetics. So if you're touching the dropper to your face, you're making the preservative system do something that it wasn't meant to do. It's not in its job description. The second mistake is saving up the serum from your sheet masks. This is a similar issue. Again, you're making the preservative system do a job that it wasn't meant to do. Single-use foil sachets are considered one of the safest types of packaging. They're meant to be single-use, there's no expected shelf life after you open it. There's not even air going into it like there is in a tube where you dispense some and then a little bit of air gets sucked back in. The preservative systems for these tend to be the weakest, so if you're saving up the extra sauce and keeping it for a week or so, then again you're making it do a job that it wasn't meant to do. It is possible that the preservative system can stand up to this, but really, that product was only ever intended to be used a few hours after opening, not a few days or a week or a month. After you've opened up the sachet to the air, then there are lots of microbes in the air, and cosmetics are really good food for microbes. It's watery, there's lots of nutrients for them to grow, sheet masks are usually at a nice skin-friendly and microbe-friendly pH. You're also probably keeping it at room temperature, which is warm enough for these microbes to usually reproduce really quickly, and so you are risking contamination. Again, with the bacteria talk, getting moisture into your products. Water is really good for microbial growth. If you have a cosmetic product, then generally you will need to have a preservative if it's got water in it, if you want it to last for longer than like a week. If there's extra water going into a product, then this can lead to trouble. The worst situation is if there's a product that has a big opening, like a hair mask in a jar, that you take into the shower and water literally drips into it. If you're adding extra water, a lot of the time this sits on top, and so this doesn't get enough preservative. That extra water will be a really good place for bacteria and microbes to start growing. Even if you just start using a product in a damp bathroom after you've showered, there might be enough moisture there to cause problems. So for example, if you get condensation inside the container, inside like the walls of a jar for example, then bacteria and microbes can start growing there. So if you want to avoid this water contamination if you go into the shower, then it's a good idea to scoop out the product and put it into a little container like one of these caps that you get from a whole bunch of different products. If you're putting on skincare in the bathroom, let your bathroom air out and dry out a bit before you start doing your skincare routine. Or you can use them in a different room, maybe your bedroom instead. Transferring your products into a different container. I've been guilty of this one in the past. It can be okay, but you have to be really careful. Firstly, the container has to be very clean. The preservative system in the product might not be designed to deal with whatever dust or bits of cardboard or whatever's inside the container. Some containers are also incompatible with certain products. Glass is generally okay, but plastics can react with preservatives or active ingredients or different solvents inside the product. Sunscreen ingredients, for example, can soak into plastics, and so that means you have less of the sunscreen ingredients in your sunscreen. They can also just dissolve the container. So if you have a really clean container, if you're only putting the product in there for a very short amount of time, or if you know that that container was designed for that purpose, then it can be okay. You can also test the container with the product so you can smear it on and look for visible changes, but sometimes the changes aren't that obvious, so just keep that in mind when you're using that product. Not applying enough sunscreen. I see a little goes a long way all the time in sunscreen reviews. The problem is sunscreen is like paint. You are trying to hide your skin from the sun. Sunscreen is tested at 2 milligrams per square centimeter to get that SPF label on the bottle. You can apply less sunscreen, but the SPF will generally go down linearly. So that means if you apply half the amount, then you get about half the SPF. But you run into more issues if you apply less than half the amount. So your skin isn't flat, it's microscopically bumpy. There are lots of hills and valleys. So when you apply the sunscreen, you fill in the valleys first. And if you don't have enough sunscreen, then you might not be covering the tops of the hills of your skin enough. And I think a lot of people do run into this issue because there are studies showing that most people apply less than half the required amount. Now, the amount that you need to apply does depend on how big your face is, but a general rule that covers pretty much everyone is a quarter teaspoon for your face, not including your ears or neck. Mixing sunscreen with other products. It's really tempting to mix a sunscreen with other products before you put it on. Some sunscreens have really bad white cast, so mixing it with, say, foundation makes it look a bit less white when you put it on. The texture of some sunscreens also just isn't great, and so that way you can dilute the texture and make it a bit more wearable. Some of us are lazy and we just want to have one step. The problem is, when you mix the sunscreen with something else, then it can interfere with the film formation. When a sunscreen is tested, it's tested on its own on bare skin, and it's really important that it forms a continuous film so that the sunscreen can be spread out evenly so you get even protection. If you add other stuff in there, it can mess up the microscopic structure of the sunscreen. Sunscreens are emulsions, they're a bit like mayonnaise. If you add too much oil or too much vinegar or too much lecithin or whatever, you can actually break that emulsion. The mayonnaise will separate, and same with sunscreens. If it separates, then you're not getting that even layer. So you shouldn't be mixing sunscreens with, well, anything. So this is things like foundations, pigment drops, and oils. So if you want other products on your face as well, then apply it in layers. In general, it's a good idea to wait 5 to 10 minutes after you've put on your sunscreen to put on extra layers like foundation. It's also a good idea to find a sunscreen that already does what you want. So if you want to avoid a white cast, then maybe look for a chemical sunscreen. If you only want to do one step, then maybe look for a tinted sunscreen that isn't too tinted so you can still apply the right amount. If you want a product that's more moisturizing, then look for a sunscreen that already has moisturizing ingredients on it, or look for a moisturizer with SPF. Leaving sunscreen in the heat. With sunscreens, it's important to have the filters distributed evenly through the whole product. It's a bit like paint, the pigment needs to be evenly distributed. If it's settled out, then you're not going to get even coverage. It's the same idea with sunscreens. Sunscreens should be formulated so that the filters are spread evenly in the product throughout the whole shelf life, but it does depend on storage. Heat is something that's really good at making sunscreens separate. So if you go to the beach and you keep the bottle in the sun, that's not good. If you keep your sunscreen in the car, you put it in the glove box, and you leave your car parked in the sun, that's also not good. I know it seems like a good idea to leave a bottle of sunscreen in the car so you don't forget it, but because of the heat, this is usually not a great idea. So a better idea would be to keep your sunscreen in your handbag where it tends to have cooler temperatures. If you're going to the beach, cover up your sunscreen with something that reflects light, so maybe a white towel. Even better, keep it in a cooler bag. Also, pay attention to the expiry date. If you're not very good at keeping your sunscreen out of the heat, then make sure you buy a new one every summer. Dermarolling over products that aren't meant to be dermarolled over. So with a dermaroller, you're opening up channels in your skin to let skincare products go deeper, and if they're not meant to go deeper, then this can be bad. Some dermarollers have shorter needles, and these don't go as deep into your skin, so they tend to be a bit safer. But most products are designed to sit on the surface of your skin. Your skin is a good barrier, so a lot of the time the products have a higher concentration, so that the amount that gets through the barrier is still effective. So you can think of it like a slow release. But if you've got these extra channels in your skin from the needles, then it's like a shortcut. It's like it suddenly all gets released at once. It's a bit like if you have an icy drink. If you drink it slowly, it's really nice, but if you drink it too fast, you get brain freeze. Or it's like pepper, if it's evenly distributed in your food and you're eating it slowly, you're getting a little bit at once, it's really nice, but if you eat a giant lump all at once, it's not great. I am really into analogies today. So the skin equivalent of this is irritation. The other thing that can happen is, again, with the microbes, if you have a product that wasn't designed to go into your skin, maybe the preservative system wasn't designed to be quite as good, you could be introducing microbes deeper into your skin, leading to an infection. So these are some of the mistakes I've been seeing around. Have you done any of these? I've definitely done a few. Are there any mistakes that I've missed? Let me know in the comments. If you like this video, click the thumbs up and the subscribe. You can also check out my blog and follow me on Instagram as well. See you next time for more beauty science.